morning and welcome everyone to this RFF live event, Environmental Justice, Research and Community Partnerships. This is the fifth event in a six-part series on environmental justice co-sponsored with the Urban Institute. I'm Margaret Walls, Senior Fellow at RFF, and I'm joined by my colleague from the Urban Institute, Anne Janod. For those of you who aren't familiar with RFF, we're an independent nonprofit research institution based in Washington, D.C. And our mission is to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement.
And the Urban Institute is also a nonprofit, nonpartisan research organization focused on the use of data, evidence, and facts to inform social and economic policy. Urban's environmental justice work employs both Urban's traditional analytical lens as well as community-based research with environmental advocates and community organizations.
So Anne and I have three goals in mind with the EJ webinar series. I always like to start with this. The first thing we're trying to do is to just educate and inform our audiences about research on various aspects of environmental justice and the important intersections between research, policy, and advocacy. The second is to bring together EJ advocates who work at the grassroots level and have intimate knowledge of the nature of problems in communities with researchers equipped with methodological tools and data. And so for that reason, we always try to have our panels include both advocates and researchers. And third, we want to identify remaining gaps in knowledge and important paths forward for policy, especially right now when both the climate crisis and a racial reckoning are finally becoming national policy priorities in the US. So our fifth event today is organized around partnership. So specifically, we're going to discuss how researchers and representatives from community organizations can work together to gain a better understanding of problems in EJ communities and ultimately design effective and fair solutions to those problems. So interestingly, the EJ movement really arose with partnerships between advocates and researchers. And we talked about this back in our first event in this series, which was last spring. And you can go back and watch that, a recording of that if you missed it. So early landmark studies such as the United Church of Christ, Toxic Waste and Race Report, work by Dr. Robert Bullard and others, combined scholarship and advocacy. But much of the larger body of research on environmental issues and the policies and programs that informs are often lack sort of sufficient meaningful input from citizens in the hardest hit communities. So designing effective partnerships, we want to do it, but it's challenging. So how do we do it to get sort of the best of both worlds? And how do we make sure that research stays balanced and rigorous, but is improved by collaborations with community organizations? How do community organizations make sure the voices of people that are deeply affected by environmental problems are meaningfully integrated in planning and priority setting, and that they get something out of the partnership? These are some of the issues we're going to talk about today.
So we are honored to have three fantastic experts on these issues for today's discussion. Eddie Bautista is Executive Director of the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance, or NEJA, which is a member-based organization of community groups in low-income neighborhoods in New York City. NEJA organizes its member groups to advocate for environmentally overburdened communities of color, especially around city and statewide issues that threaten their ability to thrive. Mr. Bautista has advised the governor's office and state legislature on power plant siting and helped write the landmark 2006 solid waste management plan for New York City. NEJA has been at the forefront of many campaigns to advance environmental and climate justice in New York, including New York State's landmark Climate Leadership and Community Protection Act, which we'll be talking a little bit more about today. Bonnie Keeler is Associate Professor in the Hubert H. Humphrey School of Public Affairs at the University of Minnesota, where she is also a McKnight Presidential Fellow, the Charles M. Denny Chair in Science, Technology, and Environmental Policy, and the co-director of the Center for Science, Technology, and Environmental Policy. Dr. Keeler works at the intersection of sustainability science and environmental economics with a particular focus on conservation and water issues. Most of her research involves direct community engagements, and she has written extensively on effective partnerships between academics, and community organizations. And Michael Mendez is an assistant professor of environmental planning and policy at the University of California, Irvine. Dr. Mendez is a member of the National Academies of Sciences Board on Environmental Change and Society, and is on the board of directors of the social justice nonprofit Alliance for a Better Community. Dr. Mendez has more than a decade of senior level experience in the public and private sectors in California. Much of that experience and knowledge is captured in his award-winning book, Climate Change from the Streets, which is a timely analysis of the politics of incorporating environmental justice into climate change policy. So welcome to all of you. And we encourage audience members to review our panelists' full bios on our event website.
Thanks, Anne. So just a quick few housekeeping notes before we get started. This is a public webinar. It's being recorded and it will be posted on the RFF website afterward. As time allows, we'll be opening up for audience Q&A at the end of the session. All audience members are muted, so we encourage you to submit your questions to the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen and feel free to put those in at any time. We'll be monitoring them and we'll try to get to as many as we can. Lastly, if you're on Twitter, please use the hashtag RFFLive. So with that, let's get started and hear from our panelists. I think we want to start with the question that we'd like each of you to weigh in on if you can. And first, it's just a basic, what do we really mean by a partnership between researchers and EJ advocates? It'd be great if you could talk about that a little bit, maybe provide some specific examples from your own experiences of partnerships that worked well, why they worked well, and kind of why they're so important. So Mr. Bautista, if we could start with you, maybe providing some perspective from the EJ advocacy side, what do you think about this?
Please call me Eddie, Margaret, and everyone. And again, thank you all, RFF and Urban Institute for having us. I think there's so much to say about researchers and their partnership with EJ groups, but I'll try to be restrained. There are three kind of basic things that I always try to impart whenever I'm working with a research institution. One is if they're interested in a partnership, they should take that literally. Like it's a real partnership, and any partnership that you all participate in, from your personal relationships to your professional, a partnership implies that there's a duality of decision making, or not duality, but at least some clear expectation that decision making, that resource sharing, that other components of whatever forms your partnership, that the partnership implies some level of equality, some level of multiple partners bringing something to that partnership, and therefore having their contributions and their perspectives honored and valued as such. And all too often over the years, partnerships have been just a box that gets checked in an NIH proposal or EPA proposal, and is not taken to heart. Second thing I would do is challenge your assumptions of what you think an EJ community group is or has in the way of resource or expertise. As was mentioned before, the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance, NEJA, my organization, is a coalition of 11 community-based organizations from the city's most environmentally overburdened communities, which by extension means we're a Black and Brown coalition. If you understand environmental impacts and the environmental justice movement, none of that will be a surprise. Among my members, we have community-based organizations that have on staff lawyers, engineers, planners. Do not think that just because someone chooses to work in a community-based organization that they somehow are either technically or educationally somewhat less sophisticated or less exposed than the research institution in question. I also have organizational members that have no budget, no staff, pure volunteer, and in fact may not. There's a mix of people in that group, people who are both educated and not. And by educated, I mean formal education. We need to understand that education means and brings so much more to collaborations than just whether you have more degrees than a thermometer, right? So that's, and I think lastly, it's the notion of, it's not just partnership, it's not just challenging assumptions, but, you know, as researchers, you know, challenging assumptions, do research, like go to the websites and then realize that the groups you're working with may have a policy agenda, may have staff, may, or may not, but it informs how you at least think of the group you're approaching. This final example is not necessarily the best when applied to researchers, but I find that its applicability across professional disciplines is applicable, which is this notion of, you know, think of yourself, whether you're a researcher, a lawyer, an engineer, think of yourself in the context, at least in an environmental justice setting, as you're a technician, right? You're bringing a specific set of tools to whatever challenge you're partnering on. So, you know, it helps tremendously to think of yourself almost as a car mechanic. Again, this is not the most environmentally sound example, but think of yourself as a car mechanic and the community as the driver with the car that has an engine issue, right? They bring it to you to diagnose and help fix the engine. But at the end of the day, that driver, that community gets back in the driver's seat and then goes off and you're on to your next project. If you approach the work with that level of humility, I think it makes sometimes for the best partnerships, but I'll stop right there.
I really like that analogy. That's great. And Bonnie, can I ask you to speak to this, but based on your experience, and again, you're coming from the academic side, but tell us what you think about this. What's a real partnership?
Yeah, that's great. And I have a list of things that I wanted to touch on, and Eddie covered a few of them already. But I just want to preface my remarks by clarifying that I can only speak from my own experience of what's worked and what hasn't worked. Every partnership is unique, and they're all based on relationships. This is really human work. So there's no one size fits all approach. So I can talk about what are some things that I think have worked well in the partnerships that I've been involved with. And I think it's important to start by recognizing what Eddie said, in that there's a whole range of different organizations, from big NGOs to EJ organizations that are very scrappy grassroots organizations that have a shoestring budget, to very well-resourced organizations with a ton of internal capacity. And so I think it's on the responsibility of academics and researchers to really, as Eddie said, do your homework before you initiate a partnership, so you have a sense of their capacity. And this is something you can do really easily without burdening those partners. You can sign up for their newsletters, you can attend their events, you can volunteer, you can visit their website. But there's really a lot you can do to understand an organization and how they work before you reach out and initiate a collaboration. And then the second is to recognize what will often be really big power differentials and difference in resources between academic organizations, research organizations, and community partners. And in the case of universities where I sit, you know, these institutions often have very problematic and exploitive relationships with communities. And that's going to create challenges for the partnerships that you aim to initiate. So I think the point is, you can't change that past, but you are still accountable to understand it and acknowledge it, and know that that history matters, and you're going to carry that institutional baggage with you when you bring that to partnerships. The third is to always bring something to the table. So I mentor a lot of students in how to do community engaged research, and one of the tendencies is to be like, well, I should just ask them what they need, and they'll know exactly how I, a graduate student in biology, can serve that community. So you have to really rethink the value proposition that you offer to community organizations. And so I have students do more of an inventory about what are the resources you actually offer to community engagement. And that's not things that they think of as their discipline expertise. So it's like, they have access to university libraries, you have access to GIS software, you have access to meeting rooms, you have access to fleet vehicles that you can rent. So in other words, it's likely that your academic expertise may not be what you, the most valuable thing you have to offer to community groups. And so that means that you're often having to rethink what are those kinds of resources or knowledge products that are actually most useful for community organizations. And then the last is just, you know, moving at the speed of trust and really recognizing that timelines are going to be very different across these kinds of of partnerships, and they take a long time to cultivate, and they may not always be fruitful. And so I think you have to be willing to go into it knowing that it's not necessarily going to be smooth, that it's likely that these relationships will be bumpy, like all relationships, especially those with the sort of legacies of researchers and environmental justice organizations. And then the last is just to enter into it with a willingness to be transformed by the partnership itself. So in my experience, I came into some of my past partnerships with a particular idea about what I thought we would work on together. And that was almost immediately thrown out the window and pivoted to work on something that was clearly a bigger priority for those community organizations. So that can be really uncomfortable as a researcher. So I ended up working on housing and gentrification issues with that partnership, stuff that I didn't know anything about, but I figured it out and we did something together that added value to them. But that required a lot of, as Eddie said, humility.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's really interesting. I don't know, Mike, do you want to add something to this discussion on this point?
Sure. I think both Eddie and Bonnie provided some great information about humility, you know, moving with the speed of trust, not putting one size fits all approaches. I just like to add two issues that I take in key principles when working with on community gauge research or co-production of research with environmental justice groups is the idea of accountability and reciprocity. And really understanding that you need to be accountable for the actions that you do, the research that you make. You can't just come in, helicopter in, do a research project and then disappear, never share your data, never provide any opportunity for the individuals to understand what happened to that research project, where did it go, did it invoke any type of policy action. And then the second issue is reciprocity. It can't just be an extractive process where the researcher is getting grants or the researcher is getting publications and, you know, career advancement without doing any projects that are really benefiting the community-based organization. So really understanding that oftentimes you are going to have to do projects that are not related to your research area, as Bonnie mentioned, or, you know, have to volunteer your time if it's going to a community meeting and, you know, putting away chairs. It's putting in the time effort to make sure that you're carrying your weight and you're providing some that added benefit to that community and not just taking in an extractive process.
Thanks, Dr. Mendez. Thanks all. So to follow on to this question and dive a little bit deeper with you all here. So, you know, EJ advocates are obviously well positioned, especially compared to researchers at academic institutions to fill the role of community outreach. Obviously, Eddie Nija fills that role well as a member organization with contacts all over the city and state. But what do you think, Eddie, needs to be done in research collaborations to ensure that EJ advocates are not pigeonholed into the outreach and convener type roles, or worse, as you said, kind of the box checking, afterthought, rubber stamping type roles? What roles should community advocates be playing in research and planning processes? And what can academic research partners do to help ensure that there's a real authentic research team culture on a project?
Absolutely, thanks. And yeah, I mean, and I think both Bonnie and Michael touched on it. Let me begin with the most, at the risk of sounding mercenary or crass, if you are engaging in a research project and you're approaching, I've yet to meet the researcher that comes to us that is not getting funded to do the research. So if you are getting funded, or even more importantly, if you're about to embark on a funding application to do research, that's the moment you reach out to community groups. Mm-hmm. And you don't reach out the way just 2 weeks ago, one of our members was reached out to by a major university here in New York. I'm not gonna name the major university in New York, but throw those three words together, you know what I'm talking about. So this university approaches one of our members. They're clearly going for a research grant. The total amount was something like $700,000-$800,000, something like that. And they were offering the community group $1,000 to sit down with them, to hear everything they've got today, to everything they've got in terms of brainstorming, whatever it is they want to brain pick, and then use that to inform the rest of their $790,000 project. It's that's just not, you guys, you would not approach a fellow university like that. So, you know, do not approach a community group whose research is central to your success in a way that diminishes what those contributions might be, right? So that's like the first thing, but it depends on what your research is, right? There is too much research still that is research for its own sake, its own end. And there's a whole other just, I don't even know how to advise researchers in that setting because the whole construct is designed to be in a siloed approach with minimal outside interference or even informing a research option. So I'll confine my remarks to those researchers that are looking for their research to do something. If you intend your research to have any sort of policy impact, even let's take the group that at least on paper in our coalition might appear as the least powerful. A group that has no funding, no budget, pure volunteer, and maybe it's, I don't know, 10, 15 people. Believe me, that little group with 10 or 15 people is likelier to get their city council person to return their call, go to their meeting, engage with them, than a university that doesn't move a single voter in their district. Like it's just, you know, if you want to be savvy as a researcher and you have a policy outcome in mind, then you need to look at your partners like the entity with agency. And I mean that small A, like that's actually going to be able to move a project. Just to give you guys one example of how this worked out for us, there was a research project we had, ten years ago. New York City was updating its comprehensive waterfront plan. At the moment, we were looking to insert provisions into the comprehensive waterfront plan that would protect a category that too many EJ communities in New York fall into. It's a New York specific thing. It's called Significant Maritime and Industrial Areas, or SMIA. It's essentially a city planning tool that's designed to cluster heavy industrial uses. There are good public planning reasons for that, but as you can imagine, there's also bad environmental and public health outcomes when you cluster a lot of polluting facilities in the same geographic area. So we were looking to improve that designation. In 2011, we had what we didn't have 10 years prior to that. These get updated every 10 years, which were climate change projections. And so all of a sudden, in partnership with Pratt Institute, we were able to layer onto what had been these existing SMIA zones, all of the polluting facilities that are permitted by DE, by our city, state, and federal environmental agencies, and a number of other agencies that permit facilities. And to our horror, we discovered that all of our neighborhoods were not just susceptible to these clusters of environmental impacts, but they were all in storm surge zones, flooding zones, the kinds of uses that if we were designing a city today, we would not put in the path of a storm surge or potential flooding event. You don't want all your heavy mercury and cadmium uses in the path of a storm surge. That's exactly what we found. And not just is that an issue in New York, but in cities like Houston, New Orleans, we saw when they had severe weather events, how dislodged chemical inventories had potential public health impacts on residents. So we were able to take that GIS overlay, present that to the Department of City Planning, and what came out of that comprehensive waterfront plan for the first time were climate change, adaptation, mitigation, resiliency initiatives, particularly targeting EJ vulnerable communities that would not have been the case had we not had that partnership with Pratt. And by the way, PS about this, we were about to present our findings to the City Planning Commission when they were looking at the comprehensive waterfront plan. They had to cancel the hearing that day because that was the day Superstorm Sandy was hitting New York. So yeah, a hearing talking about climate change had to be postponed because of a severe weather event. Can't make this stuff up, but that's an example of a real tangible policy outcome that came from a respectful partnership with a research institution and EJ.
Fantastic. Fantastic, Eddie. Thank you so much for that. Professor Mendez, I wonder, in your experiences in California, do you have any thinking or advice on this topic of how not to pigeonhole EJ groups into, you know, narrow or secondary roles? Are there community engaged methods or approaches, practices, or just considerations that you really think are important to elevate here?
Sure. I think Eddie alluded to this at the beginning. A lot of the environmental justice work that I have seen is not community engaged. It's and rarely some of these individuals are essentially just do desk research and say they're doing environmental justice research, whatever speaking to a community group. They do sometimes do some important data analysis that we need to understand where environmental hazards are. But just imagine how that data could have been a lot more richer from the outset that they talked to community groups to understand what are on the ground impacts. It might have taken their research in another direction. And my experience in California, I really have tried now, and not in all projects, but a lot of my emerging projects, is to co-author with community groups. So not only bringing them on to the grants that Eddie talks about, but also bringing them on as co-authors, co-presenters. A lot of the research that I do is what I got policy relevant research, particularly looking at wildfires and other disaster studies. My most recent co-authored work with community groups is looking at extreme wildfire events to undocumented migrants and farm workers and other outdoor workers, and community groups, both from migrant rights groups to environmental justice groups that are on the ground during and after these disasters, have provided an enormous amount of insight that I could not have gotten otherwise, or even just interviewing them. So that process of bringing them on to a sense of data ownership, as well as publication ownership, and extending that or leveraging that to policy briefings. We've done multiple policy briefings, and how impactful it has been for these advocates alongside an academic research institute to be able to tell their stories. And unfortunately, we know that policymakers and the media and other individuals provide a little bit more credence to an academic researcher. But that's the reality. But using that platform that I may have as an academic is to give it to them and let them allow to speak for themselves in these policy arenas. So I think that's been very powerful, and people have received it. These stories of the disparate impacts that wildfires are having on this very marginalized and stigmatized population has been very fruitful and very powerful. And it's something that has really changed me in terms of my own environmental justice research. I know, as Bonnie mentioned, there's not a one size fits all. That approach is not appropriate for every research project, but I'm trying to do that moving forward with some of these bigger projects to bring them in more directly.
Fantastic. Thank you, Professor Mendez. Professor Keeler, likewise, have you seen this challenge in your work, and how are you going about it? How are you addressing it?
Yeah, thanks, Anne. So your question about how to not make communities sort of pigeonholed into an outreach position, and to be honest, that is not a role that I expect my partners to play, but it's often a role that motivates their work. So if an organization agrees to collaborate, then in my experience, it's because they see value in an academic partnership as a way to better serve their communities, as a way to sort of elevate and better resource their organizations that they serve or their neighborhood. And some of my partners are themselves scholars. And so in addition to representing the concerns of their communities, they are also interested in the scholarship, but that's different for different organizations and different individuals. So you really have to figure out what it is where you're adding value to their work. And that, you know, in some cases, as Mike talked about, maybe through co-authorship of a paper. And then in other places, be like, please do not drag me into your horrible academia. Last thing I want to do is work on an academic manuscript with you. So I think that's really knowing your partners and their priorities. And the second thought I have is that I found it really doesn't work well to outsource partnerships or relationship development. So if you're relying on a community partner to do your outreach for you, unless you hold those relationships directly, you're really not in a partnership. So I don't ask, and I wouldn't ask my organizational partners to do outreach on my behalf, but I certainly ask for their recommendations of others that we should invite into our conversation or that we can, where we can expand our collaboration. And I think mutually, both of us have benefited from being able to expand our networks through the partnerships that we each bring to the table.
Yeah, great. Thank you for that, Bonnie. I want to go back to Eddie just said a moment ago, not interested in researchers doing research for research's sake, like we want to make a difference. And that sort of brings me to a question about the sort of different navigating what can be a tension between the need for EJ advocates to engage in kind of the political process, to lobby. I mean, they're advocates, that's what they're doing. And the need for academics to kind of have this neutral, impartial, apolitical kind of outlook. And also, Bonnie, I'm gonna turn to you first on this one, but you have to work, professors have to work toward tenure and maintain a scholarly profile. So how do you balance these kinds of things?
Thanks, I love this question, Margaret. I think it's something I've thought a lot about, and it's, my perspective has shifted very much over the years as I've engaged in this work. And so what I would say first off is that none of us are impartial or neutral. So let's just be clear. We all have values. We all have biases that we bring to our work. And many of us are in the careers that we're in right now because of those values, right? So we're motivated to work on issues that we care about. And I actually think that the research on topics like positionality have made a strong case that the solution is actually not to bury those values under a guise of objectivity, but rather to really acknowledge and make transparent how you select your questions and the kinds of knowledges that you privilege in your work. And I don't think that that makes you less rigorous as a scientist. You're still collecting your data, you're following best practices in your discipline. It's really more about transparency. And I think the move towards open science, things where we're really taking our methodologies and being really clear about the assumptions that we're making as we go from selecting our questions to analyzing data to thinking about community concerns and their perspectives. I think, you know, I'm very clear that I question that the questions I prioritize in my research are motivated by my values.
Thank you. And Mike, do you have something to add on this topic? I think I set Bonnie up.
Can you repeat the question again? I'm sorry.
Yeah, just the need for, as an academic, to get tenure, to try to maintain this sort of scientific, unbiased, scholarly approach to your work, whereas advocates are advocates. They're lobbying. They have their, you know, that's what they're about. So how do you navigate that?
Well, that is a very tight rope to walk on, particularly me being pre-tenure as assistant professor, Bonnie being associate professor, tenured professor already. And that's something that I have grappled throughout my career. I come to academia as a second career. I spent many years in the public policy arena, working for the governor's office, working for the state legislature on these environmental justice issues. So I had already come into this career with a very policy-oriented, a policy-relevant type of focus and understanding that environmental justice research really needs to have fundamentally some sort of scaling up solutions, scaling up science. So it is something that I have thought about it in the past, but I just charge ahead knowing that this research is so important, and translating academic papers to policy briefs, having policy meetings directly either at the federal level or at the state and local level is quite important. So that idea of providing that authorship, sometimes community groups are never asked if they want to be a part of that research design, and then really understanding again how do you translate this information. And I think that's being valued more in the tenure process. In our academic careers is that policy impact that you're having and how people are reading your work and how it's being translated into real change. And I think I'm happy to see that change in our sort of our academic institutions to some extent.
Thank you, Professor Mendez. I'd like to follow on to this question and maybe zoom out, get a little bit more big picture. So scholars have written about the connection between a white power culture and the ways that dominant Western cultures and society tend to value scientifically produced knowledge, which often comes from, you know, elite institutions, is published in peer-reviewed scientific journals, et cetera. And often diminishes and disregards community-based and community-produced knowledge and knowledges. So how can research teams walk this tightrope that we're talking about? You know, on the one hand, countering these insidious and often unseen paradigms of oppression, while also maintaining a fact-based and rigorous analytical practice. I think that there's maybe a parallel here with citizen science and crowdsourcing, which are being increasingly recognized as legitimate sources of knowledge, but there may be a greater tension around these issues in some EJ spaces. Mike, let's turn to you first. Do you see this challenge in your work, in your research, in your practice? And if so, how do you overcome it? What recommendations do you have?
Excuse me. Yes, there's definitely that tension between what the community groups are advocating for and sort of the rigor and focus that we're trying to do. Like the current project that I'm have a grant from the National Science Foundation Early Career Faculty Award that's in conjunction with the National Center for Atmospheric Research. So we're looking at the exposure rates, the air quality exposure rates of wildfire that are happening to these migrant communities. And we're directly partnering with indigenous Mexican migrant rights groups, as well as environmental and labor justice groups. And they definitely have their own approach to what they want to see happens with this project, either, you know, advocating for the County Board of Supervisors for change in terms of occupational health and safety standards for these workers, and an expectation that we take our initial findings the policymakers even before they have been peer reviewed. So that is something that I'm currently debating and we're grappling with. I feel comfortable enough in the research project with both qualitative and air quality scientists that we're working with that these disasters are happening, and it's sort of life and death. It is life and death issues that are happening. People having a long-term and acute health reactions from some of these disasters that are happening every year. So there's an ethical and moral obligation if the policymaking process is moving forward and we have some level of confidence in the data to be able to share that. So even though it hasn't been fully peer reviewed, some of the research projects that we're working on, we do talk internally if it's the right situation to do this. And we've made that decision as a research body, a research collective, that it's important to get these findings out and early.
Fantastic. Bonnie, Eddie, do you have anything to add here? Do you have perspectives on this, you know, admittedly very big question? Go for it, Bonnie. I see you unmuted.
Yeah, sure. So I think, you know, first it comes back to how we choose the questions that we resource in our work. And then second, it's thinking about the types of knowledge products that really motivate the collaboration and what we, I guess, define as legitimate sources of knowledge. So if a community member says, you know, I perceive my neighborhood to be unsafe, or I perceive the air quality in my neighborhood to be unhealthy, or my community fears gentrification and displacement, those are real. I mean, that's data, right? You've just heard from the community about their concerns. You may also do a GIS analysis or collect data from air quality sensors that may show a different picture, right? But those aren't necessarily in conflict because people's perceptions of their environment matter. That to me is data. And so in my work, I use like a lot of qualitative and quantitative methods. It's participatory work. Sometimes it's deliberative work. Sometimes it's historical and archival work. I've partnered with historians and ethnographers. Just because I see the value in so many different ways of knowing and so many different ways of framing these complex questions that often have historical roots and messy contemporary trade-offs that seem all very urgent to solve and moving towards more sustainable, equitable futures. And I think it can be very powerful for community members to see their lived experiences validated in academic research. But then I also think there's a broader category, which is more often where I work, which are community-oriented knowledge products that are not designed to be published in peer-reviewed journals. They're ArcGIS story maps, they're physical maps in lots of different formats. There's, you know, websites and fact sheets and toolkits. And I often keep those in separate buckets so that they don't get meshed together with the competing interests of those different audiences.
Thank you, Bonnie. Eddie, anything to add here?
Yeah, sure. Thanks. And just a quick note for folks who are interested in that initial research collaboration that I spoke of with Pratt Institute, if you go to our website, just Google New York City Environmental Justice Alliance, go to our website. That particular initiative is in the page called Waterfront Justice Project. It also has an interactive map that actually shows you where the clusters are vis-a-vis storm surge and other projections. So to turn to the previous question and this question, just a couple of just reactions. It's important for the research and academic community to understand or grapple with the fact that y'all don't have the market cornered on research and rigor, right? Like, we don't want lousy research, and we're pretty rigorous about our outcomes and how we invest our work. So please, you know, let's be clear that research and rigor is something we're all interested in. And secondly, the issue about impartiality, Bonnie touched on it. Like, I've yet to meet the totally impartial from the planet of Vulcan kind of research. I've not met that person. Like, you know, you oftentimes, most of the times when I've engaged with researchers or academics, they're coming to us because they already have an outcome that they are researching to check the premise, right? So, like, you're not impartial if you're already developing a research project to prove a concept, right? So, and here's where it gets insidious and leads to this next question about, you know, white privilege and how oppression plays out. First of all, it would be helpful. Let's look at Western thought for a second. Again, it's important to remember that, you know, Western civilization did not invent mathematics, right? Let's be clear. If you want to be real about this, go to Middle East, go to Mesopotamia. That's where the foundation of math began, right? So long as you understand that the world is broader than Western civilization and that other parts of the world made contributions before, you know, while folks were still, you know, moving from hut to hut in England or wherever else. But more seriously, I mean, I think it's as white residents in the United States, to the degree that you have any interest in how race plays out, there's a lot of work to be done on that end before you even reach your professional capacity, right? My feeling is that as a white resident of the United States, the better you understand how racism structurally, institutionally plays out, the better a researcher, academic you're going to be. If you're coming to this work with an unsophisticated racial analysis, I promise you, your end product will be missing some key data points, right? So if you don't even, and so that's where the research and practitioner part comes in. Like, even if you're not even if you don't have any civic interest in racial justice as a white resident in the United States, then as a practicing research practitioner, academic, if you're doing a study, your racial justice analysis is going to have an impact on your ultimate research product. So again, if you don't care about it from a civic perspective, for God's sake, care about it to have a good, you know, rigorous research outcome. And I have a particular example of something that we're working on. In fact, with RFF, shameless pitch. But I'll wait for that till I get to the next round.
That's my question for you, Eddie, right now. I think we want to ask some specific research and projects that you all have going in. So Eddie, tell us a little bit about this project with RFF, some of my colleagues, and three universities, which is looking at various policy scenarios to achieve the goals of the New York State Climate Leadership and Community Protection Act. So tell us a little bit about that partnership you've got going.
Absolutely. And I'm going to keep some of the, more impressive parts of that research project. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to keep it a little close because I don't know if anyone from the state of New York is listening in on this. And I'm not sure how they would appreciate my characterization of the study project. So I'm going to share with you all a version that would play well with the state of New York. So the state of New York is in the process, has been for the last year, of implementing the Climate Leadership and Community Protection Act. If you have any interest in the environmental climate, I would strongly urge you all to look up the New York State Climate Leadership and Community Protection Act. It is, by all accounts I've read, the most ambitious climate action plan by any of the states. It's in fact such a landmark law that it inspired the Biden administration, the Justice 40 initiative, for example, which I have, and a lot of us have some significant concerns with, its implementation notwithstanding, just taking a step back and what it attempts to address are a lot of the same issues that we were identifying in the New York State climate law. So, the Biden administration clearly said they were patterning that initiative after what we have been doing in New York. What we're working on with RFF is two big components of what's happening with this. One is all of the policy initiatives that are going to be required to meet the climate law goal. Just to kind of level set with everyone, so the New York State climate law essentially is an economy-wide emissions reduction, 100% net zero goal for the state of New York. Essentially by 2050, New York State needs to reduce its greenhouse gas, its carbon footprint below, I think, 2005 levels by 85%. The remaining 15% will be met through a mix of offset and other initiatives, which was when we got the law passed, that 15%, there was a lot of time we spent on making sure that issues that we've been calling false solutions that in fact are being promoted in many cases by deep pocketed research institutions. And just to give you guys one clear example, there has been this enormous spike over the last year of a push for green hydrogen, and so much so that if you look at the federal infrastructure bill, literally billions of dollars are being set aside for R&D, research and development, on how to make green hydrogen work. And to our great alarm in the EJ world, green hydrogen is also being proposed for power plants to basically move power plants using green hydrogen as yet one more bridge fuel, notwithstanding the fact that green hydrogen requires blending with natural gas to work in a power plant setting. If you want to combust, as power plants do, your material to generate power, one of the things that we found that the combustion of green hydrogen emits large amounts of nitrogen oxide, of NOx emissions. So this is one of the new kind of bright, shiny objects that institutions and academic partners are looking to try to get access to the billions of dollars in R&D for green hydrogen and other solutions that are being promulgated as short-term bridge solutions that, of course, at least from our perspective, of course, means a disproportionate impact on our communities, right? So that withstanding, the partnership with RFF is to look at, and a couple of other academic partners, Yale, UC Davis, looking at the policies that are being analyzed by the state of New York to reach those targets, and what will those policies that are being promulgated, how do those policies match up to what, say, an environmental justice plan would be to reduce greenhouse gas emissions? We suspect that our more ambitious, aggressive climate policy prescriptions, we believe, will show a greater potential emissions reduction drop than what the state, what government will ultimately put forward. Then there's another part of the research project with RFF and our academic partners, where we're going to be looking at actually mapping a disadvantaged community category that was just adopted by the state of New York to meet our climate law. And so while the state goes through its disadvantaged community regulatory process to make that part of official state regulation, we will, in partnership with RFF and academic partners, be able to put on the street, this is how disadvantaged communities will look like in the state of New York. What are the disadvantaged communities in Rochester, in Buffalo? And like, so that is a really exciting partnership that is also, you know, being complicated by what becomes the usual government. You think you're going to reach a deadline by the end of 21. Guess what? They pushed it out to the first quarter of 22. What does that do in terms of our research reporting obligations? It's all complicated. It's a really exciting partnership, and I've gone on too long. I'll stop there.
That's fantastic, Eddie. So exciting. Thank you for sharing more details about your work. Let's stay in the last few minutes that we have left today. Let's stay on the climate policy topic and turn to California. So as many of our listeners probably know, California passed AB 32, the Global Warming Solutions Act, back in 2006, which set targets for statewide emissions reductions, established a cap and trade program and other various policies. And then starting in 2010, a number of additional laws were passed that addressed local air pollution and a number of EJ concerns. SB 535, for example, mandates that 25% of available monies in the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund go to projects that provide benefits to disadvantaged communities. So, Mike, you're very familiar with the climate policy landscape in California. Your book, Climate Change from the Streets, describes the role that the EJ community has played and continue to play in driving state policy. Can you just unpack this for us a bit? Can you tell us about how and why things changed after AB 32 passed, and how EJ groups were so effective in their advocacy? And I just want to pull one example from your book. You wrote that through a continual process of conflict and collaboration, EJ communities have become central to the conversation. Can you elaborate on this for us?
Yes, definitely. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk about sort of these conflicts and collaborations that have been existing for almost 20 years. So we often hear about the Green New Deal as being transformative over the last 5 years. And while I'm highly supportive of the Green New Deal, I'm here to say there's nothing new about the Green New Deal. Environmental justice groups in California, as I mentioned before, for nearly two decades have been engaged in all-out street fights with mainstream environmentalists, scientists, economists, market-based supporters of environmental solutions about what they should be focusing on in terms of climate change. So as it was mentioned before, we all have our positionality, our own and values, and quite frankly, our own worldviews when it comes to climate change, of what we how we conceptualize it, climate change from various policy scales, of it being a statewide, nationwide, global issue that's impacting community, impacting ecosystems and the wilderness out there, and not looking at climate change back in our own local neighborhoods, climate change in the streets. And I think that's a fundamental differences between what was going on in the early years of California's climate change, that people were speaking from structural locations that were worlds apart, valuing sort of this, what environmental justice groups would call their trickle-down environmental policy, where these global solutions, looking at climate change happening, you know, and it's sort of a vacuum, not really understanding that fossil fuel economy is really driving climate change. And it's not just about this, what I call carbon reductionist approach or carbon fundamentalist approach, but climate change and carbon emissions has co-pollutants and other types of pollution that stays at the local level that directly impacts public health. So really trying to meld on, you know, a more holistic, robust idea of what climate change is, what type of pollution that should we target, and having that focus on co-benefits. So that's why I really talk about that conflict, and where individuals early on just want to focus on that carbon reductionist, carbon fundamentalist type of approach without looking at equity, without looking at the economy, and without looking at public health. So environmental justice group really in California in 2004, 2005, and 2006, really pushing the envelope of what we now know as the Green New Deal, of having that equity, public health, and economic focus. So some of the issues that Eddie mentioned about Justice 40, some can argue also that California was the leader in terms of creating the First in Nation Climate Change Community Benefits Fund, which first started at 25% of the climate investments and now has reached to 40%. But actuality and annual review shows that over 50% of California's climate investments are coming into disadvantaged communities. And California was also the first to adopt the California Environmental Health Screening Tool, which is essentially what Biden administration and other states want to do to identify what is environmental justice, where is it, and how do we measure it, and how do we use that tool as an institutionalized scientific tool for state agencies, regulatory boards to use to target resources for enforcement and for investment. So those are a couple of the issues, but of course, California, I'll end with this, California's climate change programs are not perfect by any means. There's still a lot of controversy, particularly on cap and trade, market-based mechanisms. A lot of people see cap and trade as being inequitable to environmental justice communities. It allows oil companies, major polluters, to continue to pay to pollute without really adopting new technologies or more sustainable type of practices to halt the public health implications in local communities. So that's an ongoing battle in California. It's where's cap and trade going to lead? And how's it going to be reformed? But there are some positives in terms of the environmental health screening tool, the climate change community benefits funds, and then this really strong focus on equity, public health, and economic co-benefits.
In the 2 minutes that we have left, here we go again, and I apologize to the audience for, I want to do one audience question real quick and see if I can get quick responses. And because I thought this one question was interesting. Somebody from a local group in Maryland on responsible transit says, sometimes there's general apathy from the community at getting involved, language gaps, fears of becoming involved because of immigration status, and sort of hard to kind of get engagement, I think is the issue they're pointing to. Do either any of you want to weigh in on that really quickly here in a few minutes? That hurdle? Bonnie? I don't know. Have you observed that?
Yeah, that's real. And I think that's a really common perspective that we should, you know, you should expect as a researcher working with communities that they're going to experience a lot of barriers for their participation. And it could come in all sorts of forms. And that might mean you really need to rethink how you host meetings, where you go to meet community members. Do you provide childcare? Are you offering food? You know, there's a lot of ways where you need to be attentive to the ways in which communities want to engage, want to participate, and how you can do that in a way that doesn't burden them. But I think, you know, there aren't always solutions to that dynamic either. It's just hard.
Thank you. We're at 1 o'clock. I'm going to have to end it on that. Thank you so much to all of our panelists today. Thanks to the audience for joining us. This event was recorded. I want to remind everyone it can be rewatched in full at rff.org, our website, and where you can find out more about subscribing to RFF content and supporting RFF. So thank you so much to these terrific speakers for joining us. We're so grateful for your time. We'll provide links on the RFF event webpage to some of their recent publications and other useful readings. We try to do that after each of these webinars. So be sure to check the website out in a day or two. And thank you so much. Have a great day, everyone.